Greetings, welcome to RLM TV.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood here in downtown Miami. We're coming to you live at RLM TV, and it's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful day of great grace.
Yeah, this is an awesome time of the energy of the lightnings of God the Father, bringing forth the path into the heavenlies. We've often read that verse in Matthew where it says, Jesus Christ in the red letters, I'm not going to be coming to the left or the right, but I'll be coming like the lightnings of the sky. Well, how many of y'all know that's the revealing of the lightning path of Enoch? He was directly quoting the lightning path of Enoch, which was considered scripture by all Orthodox Jews in the days of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. So he's really in this time right now of revealing the lightning path in the heavenlies. And at the same time, when the lightning path in the heavenlies is revealed, guess what? Every other path is obliterated. Wide is the path to destruction. Many find it. Few is the path to everlasting life. And only a couple find it. So that means that simply the couple that find it are the patriarchs. It's true. That's what patriarchs are. We have Joseph the righteous of Yesod the moon. We have Hod and Netzah of Moshe and Aaron, the priesthood and the priest and the high priest and the prophet. We have Jacob, Israel of Tiferet the sun, sons without end, worlds of sons without end, all of them being Israel, all of them being Jacob, our patriarch. And we have Isaac of Gevra of Mars, the red planet. And we have Abraham of Hesed, the loving kindness of Jupiter. And this lightning path of the patriarchs is revealed in these days. And Jesus Christ said, when the path of lightnings is revealed in the heavens, that will be the sign of my second coming, which means, guys, it's very close. So now the only question is are we going to get into the path of lightnings or just say no? Well, in my Torah studies today, I want to share just a couple things in before we get into the tribe of Levi, which will be our main point today, is talking about the tribe of Levi and what it is today. But you need to understand a few things. The Lord Jesus specifically said only the Hebrew letters would be fulfilled. Come and see. For truly I tell you, until the sky and earth pass away and perish, not one smallest letter or one little hook identifying certain Hebrew letters will pass from the law, Torah, until all things it foreshadows are accomplished. Jesus Christ, Matthew 5:18. And again, this is important stuff here. The Lord Jesus explicitly addresses those charismatic believers in the future who would disregard Torah. He says they won't get into heaven, but will go to eternal damnation, come and see. And then I will say to them openly, publicly, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who act wickedly, disregarding my commandments, my Torah law. Jesus Christ, red letters, Matthew 7, 23, Amplified Classic. Remember, Orthodox Judaism requires a Kabbalistic interpretation. Otherwise, the person was considered a heretic in all Judaism then and now. The Sermon on the Mount establishes the Hebrew Orthodox Kabbalistic Torah of Messiah Jesus Christ as true and real authentic Christianity.
So good.
Forever. And the most important mitzvah you'll ever do your entire life is the critical mitzvah of successfully serving your spouse. Mm-hmm. Your spouse is a more critical mitzvah than any other mitzvah Yad Vavheh will command you to do in this life.
That's powerful.
It's true. All right, let's get right into Levi.
All right, let's go.
The tribe of Levi.
Oh, that's a cool picture.
Dun, dun, dun. Levi is the cleric, the priest, the full-time minister. Levi's mother was Leah. Levi was the center encampment around the tabernacle in the wilderness. So all the other tribes were around Levi, and Levi worked in the center. The very center of life in Israel is the priesthood of the tribe of Levi, according to the pattern in the wilderness. And the flag of the Urim and Veturim is the flag of Levi. And it was three colors.
You know, I believe that they were in the center camp because they were fighting on two fronts. They would fight in both the natural and in the spiritual. That's from the 12 patriarchs. I remember we studied that earlier this last year. And it talks about the Levites dying, fighting and dying in visible wars and invisible wars in the stars. And so really the tribe of Levi, which is what Brandon and I are operating in, you know, spiritually and taking, you know, territorial dominance in the natural realm when we go and we pioneer through places like here in Miami, we see things begin to change. The point of coming to Florida, one of those main points was punching a hole in the heavens. And there were signs and wonders all over since we came to Florida in the news reporting hole punch formations in the clouds in the sky, hole punch over the sky. And that's what we'd been saying was what the Lord had told us was to come here and punch a hole in the heavens spiritually, but it manifested as a sign and a wonder. And so the tribe of Levi, why is it important for the other tribes to support Levi? Because we're fighting on two fronts here. We go out into the natural dimension to take back what belongs to the people, all the tribes, right? We fight for all the tribes of Israel. Levi does not just fight for Levi. We fight for all the tribes, all the 12 tribes.
Every Israelite knew that in the days of Moses and Aaron. Also, this is their flag. It was divided into three parts, the black, the red, and the white, which was the complete obliteration of Balaam's evil eye. That's really what this flag represents. And the flag had the high priest's breastplate, what you see on your screen right now, in the center of the black, red, and white, separated in one-thirds. So again, the very priesthood is to completely separate from the evil eye of Balaam, which is the Kelepot and all the fallen angels, into the Shekinah of the good eye of the patriarchs of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we'll see that that even plays a part in the flag of Levi in just a minute.
All right.
Levi's stone was a smaragd.
Say that five times
fast. A smaragd. Okay, now.
Smaragd.
Listen, this is some deep stuff. This is from Chabad.org, the highest level of Jewish scholarship on earth, Chabad.org. This is the information from that. So The color of his flag was one-third white, one-third black, one-third red, and embroidered thereon was Aaron's breastplate with the Urim and the Thummim. All right. You might be asking, what is the Smarag? The Smarag. You say that five times fast. Why don't we type the Smarag in the comments right now?
That's how I feel when I wake up first thing
in like
the morning.
It's like Smeagol, but it's a Smarag. Now, you might think, well, that looks just like an emerald. That's what I thought. Completely untrue. I'd never heard of this stone until doing this research. But the gemstone, according to our highest Jewish scholars on earth today that have researched this for thousands of years, the gemstone of Levi was this Smaragd.
Wow.
The Smaragd was the stone of Levi. It is green like the emerald, but was a completely different stone. The emerald, according to most Chabad Center Torah scholars, belonged to the tribe of Zebulun. So it's, you know, a lot of Christians think it's Judah, but that's not scholarly with the Jewish community. The Jewish community really supersedes Christian scholarship in every sense of the word. And we need to really return to the Hebrew scholarship during these days, since that's the only part Jesus said that would be fulfilled. Matthew 5:18, he's only fulfilling the Hebrew words. That's in the red letters now. Matthew 5:18, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I'm only fulfilling the Hebrew. That means there's no fulfillment of Greek or Latin. Zero. Only Hebrew. That's why it's so important. The Urim and the Thummim, or Hebrew, Urim and Ve-Thummim, meaning lights and perfections. Urim means lights. Ve-Thummim in Hebrew means perfections. This was on the flag of the black, red, and white to ward off the evil eye of Balaam and Balaam's sons, which is all the demonic keeping it out of the camp, amen? Mm. A demon-free zone was the plan from the beginning.
No.
Lights and perfections. According to most traditions, the Urim and Thummim were a piece of parchment with God's four-letter name, YHVH, written on it. And they put it right underneath the breastplate. In ancient Israel, when a decision of national significance was needed, the high priest was consulted. Within the fold of the high priest's breastplate were the Urim and Thummim, lights and perfections. According to most traditions, the Urim and Thummim were a piece of parchment with God's four-letter name written on it. Its function was to serve as an oracle, divining whether or not the Jewish people should take a certain course of action, and was to be used only by the king, the Jewish high court, or a person needed by the whole community, such as a general. When its services were needed, the Kohen Gadol, high priest, would stand facing the Holy Ark of the Covenant with the questioner behind him. The individual desiring an answer would ask a simple yes or no question, such as, shall we go to war? The Kohen Gadol would meditate until he reached divine inspiration or go into a trance. Then certain, or you could just say, was blissed out. It's true. He would meditate on the question in his heart until he was in a state of peace or supernal bliss. Then, guys, the miraculous would happen. Certain letters on the breastplate upon which the names of the 12 tribes were written would appear to protrude or light up, producing an answer. These gemstones would come out of the breastplate or light up. Woo! Additionally, the breastplate contained the names of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The Cave of Treasures, guys. It all goes back to the Cave of Treasures. And the words Shifte, Yeshurun, Tribes of Jeshurun, thus featuring all 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet that created the heavens and the earth in the beginning. The Urim and Thummim were lost after the destruction of the first temple. According to another tradition, it exists, but it ceased to work It stopped lighting up. Now, what's so fascinating about all this is, as Christians, we have Jesus Christ come into my heart, and guess what? He now lights us up from the inside exactly as the high priest did in the Old Testament. So now we get our answers from within, from the Lord within, the Holy Spirit, those who love me, who are my sheep, my disciples, they hear my voice and they obey me. So the obedience of hearing is always with light and direction and protrusion. There are things that will come out of you. There were things, you know, maybe it be deliverance, maybe it be just things being ejected from you, but it's mostly the rivers of the Holy Spirit, John 7:38, that flow out of us in these days that direct the course of our life. And we know we're being directed by the Holy Spirit if we're being led into the protocol of these 12 boundary stones of life in Israel. He set up the wisdom of Israel, the patriarchs of Israel, as an eternal patriarch system. We see that in Galatians, we read about the 12 tribes in Revelation. It's not just for a new covenant reality. It is the old covenant and new as one. And I think we need to understand that in a Hebrew Kabbalistic understanding today. Because a lot of the people of this world right now have gone into the Kelopot just to find answers from the spiritual world. They're going to the Kabbalah centers of Madonna. They're going to the Kabbalah centers of Taylor Swift. They're going to the Kabbalah centers of Gentiles. And instead of finding God, they're finding the Kelopot, the fallen angels, and they're getting really, really augured. And so now it's the time for our heavenly witness as Christians and messianic believers. You know, Jew or Gentile doesn't matter in Christ, it is written. What matters is that Christ is in us. We're all red worms, according to Torah. You understand that? Everyone with flesh is a red worm. Why? Because you have blood. So when we divide into these principality divisions and we say we're something different according to nations and traditions, we really break the tradition, oral and written, of the Torah law of Jesus Christ. And we have to repent and get back into the wisdom of Torah. We read about how the very judgments that are coming upon this world are judgments for those that have rejected Torah. We will find the Orthodox Jews in a pretty good place in the coming days who are faithful to Torah, that rejoice in Torah, that traverse Torah, that are Jews not just outwardly but inwardly. You'll find them close to Jesus, and they will all confess the name in the days ahead. I'm certain of it. I have no doubt that many of them are already bearing the fruit before they even know the name of Mashiach that they talk about all day long from sunrise to sunset. They say Mashiach 10,000 times a day. Next, I tell you, very soon, next week, next month, next year, they'll say Mashiach Yeshua. Mashiach Yeshua. And you're going to start to see the joy of the Orthodox Jews as they're restored. They're faithful to Torah, but you have to know the name. So, the Jews need Jesus, no doubt about it. But we need the wisdom of the Jews now, the wisdom of Torah, more than ever before. And that's why we're going into the wisdom of the prophets, the scriptures, and Torah law, in order for us in these days to be safe and protected by the provision that God the Father has given us, because He won't give any more. He's not giving out a secondary provision because we didn't understand the first provision. Understand this now. When He provided Sinai and the scriptures and the Torah, and when He set up the boundary stones of Israel, when He set up the boundaries of the nations, He's not going to change that because we're in the 21st century and everyone's entitled and has so much everywhere. When it comes down, it's permanent. And it's our job as red worms, which is Adamites. That's really what all the earth is. All nations are Adamites, which in Hebrew is little red worms. As little red worms, we need to submit to what has already been provided for us. And then we will find the path of lightnings and develop our divinity in the rungs of the patriarchs. Amen.
Amen. You know, that's why they always try to make it about, you know, male versus female, black versus white, you know, South American versus Mexican, whatever it is, it could be anything. And yes, there have been horrible things done, you know, in the name of, you know, racism. There's been horrible things done in the name of misogyny. But what is the real plan? All the picketing in the world can only get so far, right? What do we do? Mainly we vote with our dollars, things like that. You know, put things on social media. There's been all kinds of things. But what is the real ticket here to really change things? Because, you know, there are those people, that 1% elite, they're sitting real nice while everybody else down below is fighting over peanuts.
True.
And getting emotional, you know, getting their emotions hurt and sinning against each other violently while they sit tight on the top of the mountain, and they have no right to be there. The only people who have the right to be there are the righteous and the holy and the elect of God. So you want to become one of those people, because the time that we're coming into is where the kingdom is going to be handed over to the righteous, the elect, and the holy. It's not going to be the rat race as usual. They think it's going to go on forever and ever, that God doesn't see the wickedness they've perpetrated over the years. Oh, he sees it, and the time is coming. Their time is coming for judgment. That's what's happening. And so basically what you need to do is get to the ladder of Jacob, the true ladder of Jacob, because here's the thing that you need. We know we need Torah. We know we need the Holy Spirit of God. We need the Word and the Spirit. But what do? You know, God gave his Torah to the Jews, but then he wanted to draw them to jealousy so that they're, you know, because they got really puffed up. We have the Torah, we're the chosen people, right? By the time the Torah made flesh, Jesus Christ,
they became dwelt entitled among them. No doubt.
Yeah, they
about
got
it.
Entitled. That's the temptation. Once you start doing better in life, don't turn into a sack of human feces.
No, that's self-absorption.
That's
no,
the thing.
Just Torah absorption, guys. We must remain humble to grow in our Creator.
Right, and so a lot of times what God will do before he brings you an increase of wealth is he's going to temper you, give you a little bit of an increase at your job, a little bit more favor with different people. Maybe now you got a better car. Maybe you came from the streets. Now you got a good car. You got a house. You got a wife, you know, or you have kids. You start to have a little bit of something, and all of a sudden the nose starts going upward and skyward. And you're like, okay, let's just calm down, buckwheat. Let's stay humble. And it's a term of endearment, right? God loves us, so he doesn't want to see the ego get out of control. How many times have you seen somebody, they make it big, they get their big break, they get famous, they get rich, and then guess what? Whoo, there they go.
They leave the ghetto and forget their foundations.
Right, and not everybody, like some, you know, people remember or they give back, but really don't let the ego, which is the self nature, don't let that balloon out of control. That's why when God gives us a little bit of an increase, he's waiting to see, all right, did you learn this time? And you get tempered in that. That's why it's good when you're in the marketplace. Notice the little nuances of your behavior, thought, speech, and emotion towards others, and how you speak about yourself, how you carry yourself, how you speak about others. If all of a sudden now you're getting better money at work, now all of a sudden people who never respected you at work, they respect you. Now you're having better clientele, you're getting better deals, and then all of a sudden they're the nose is going up again. You know, or you start to talk down to the people who talk down to you. Like when you weren't doing well at work and they look down their nose at you and put you down and try to put you in a corner and take all your credit, and they really mistreated you. Now when you have the upper hand, are you going to murder them? And by I mean murder, not like actually murdering them, but are you going
to evil eye them?
Yeah, are you going to evil eye them?
That's what murder is.
So you can't do unto others as others have done unto you. If you want to take the high road, which is the highway of holiness, you've got to take the higher way, trusting that God is a rewarder of those who seek him. Instead of taking vengeance, like, oh, I'm going to show them now. I can really take it out on them. now I'm the favored one. No, like, that's petty human behavior. Very low energy, low vibration. It's not wisdom and it's not true love. Real love has the power to forgive someone who's not even going to apologize to you. And what happens, there's a transfer when you do that. When those people who are putting you down at work, trampling all over you, just giving you the hardest time, now you've got the upper hand, and now you've got the favor. So what are you going to do? You're not going to do to others as others have done to you. Now you have the opportunity to treat them the way that you would have liked to be treated if you were in that situation. And it doesn't mean you give them your power. It doesn't mean you give them the authority to trample all over you. It just means you don't sin against them with that evil eye. And you have good will toward all mankind. You don't wish horrible things to be happening to anybody else.
Amen.
And be it true in your heart. And if it's a struggle to forgive those people, you want to take that in prayer and just release them in forgiveness in prayer and just give them to the Father who created the universe and say, you know what? I'm struggling to forgive this person because that was rough. You know, but let me just go ahead and give them to you. This is the best that I can honestly do right now, and I'm asking for your ability to forgive in a way that I've not been able to forgive. And the creator of the universe, what he actually takes into account your authenticity, right? That's something that matters to the creator of the universe. He is the most authentic and most real in his love. So when you go before the creator and the master of the universe, you're going to get back the way you give, if that makes sense. Like, what energy you're bringing to that is, I want to be authentic and not fake, because he knows anyway, right? Love knows. True love is only sourced in YHWH. He's the master of the universe. He created all things, and this is the way it works. When you come before him, and now you're going to be honest, and you're not going to be bitter. And if you are bitter, you're going to say that. You're not going to cover it up. And when you begin to be just honest and authentic, that's what the creator is looking for, is authenticity. Because there's 100 million, hundreds of thousands of people praying, trying to get his attention every day. Hey, look at me, God, you know, trying to call out to the universe, and they may not know who created it. Hey, look at me, answer my prayers. But what is he looking for? We all know what people are looking for. Girls, gold, glamour, glory, money, power, fame, wealth, boys, stars. Attention, stars. Yeah, stars, elevation,
yeah.
Influence, power. And he hears that crap every day. Can you imagine God's email inbox, his junk mail? Oh, we got another one. God, please bless me, money with girls, and I can be like you, God, and money, bless me with money. And then, all right, junk mail. Like, yeah. This one, and another one, this one looks like someone, the next Hitler. Yeah, probably, no. Can you imagine God's junk mailbox?
An Israelite must be meager in his desires for things of this world. You have to sacrifice all of that idolatry to merit any actual rewards that are deserving of your obedience to the heavenly commandment. You know, it was the obedience of Moses for years, guys, decades and decades and decades, that led him back to Pharaoh to save Israel. He didn't even ask for the money. Mm-hmm. He just asked for the people that we could go sacrifice to our God, Yadavaveh, in the wilderness.
Yeah.
If you read Torah, but you know what? Because he sought and obeyed the heart of God with such a great mitzvah, Pharaoh coughed up all the gold of the nation too.
Yeah.
Nowadays, people are so insanely out of their mind idolatrous. They'll do anything for a buck. They'll murder, they'll steal, they'll lie, they'll manipulate.
Mm-hmm.
That wickedness is the evil eye.
Yeah.
the love of money is the root of all evil, Mashiach said. And that's absolutely more true today than ever before. We need to have the roots of David and not the roots of all evil. That needs to be the foundation of our hearts, which is the good eye of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob blazing with the Father's throne and his attention and in his desires and nothing else. And then those things, when you really pass your tests and you're not idolatrous and lustful and greedy, those things can be added unto you also, it is written.
Did you know that the Lord and Master of the universe is not looking for very spiritual people?
That's so true.
He's not looking for very spiritual. Did you know he's not looking for very strong prayer warriors right now?
Nope.
He's not looking for that. The Master and Lord of the universe right now, his eyes are ranging throughout the earth. He's not looking for prophets and apostles right now.
Truth.
He's not. He's not interested in any of that crap right now. He's not. You know, the Master and Lord of the universe, he's not looking for someone who can fulfill their destiny and just wants to fulfill their destiny. He doesn't care about that. Do you know what he cares about? You can leave in the comments if you know. What is God looking for?
A broken and contrite spirit.
Yeah, and what the Master and the Lord of the universe really desires is some very close friends. He wants to have he wants very close friends who love him. That's actually what he wants, by the way. He doesn't want fake friends. He wants authentic friends.
So true.
Wow. Did you know where you get the desire to want to have true friends from?
Heaven.
Yeah. God's like that.
That's how it is in heaven.
Yeah. He wants to have some close friends who really get it. If you're just out here about prophecy and apostleship and destiny,
ministry,
forget about
works.
It. Go somewhere else.
My tribe, me, myself, and
oh,
I.
Oh my goodness. I want to be a successful businessman.
I'm doing mitzvahs for men instead of Yarivah.
Garbage. Go away.
We're not even in Israel. We need to be in Israel. We need to go into the center of that. Whatever flag is flying over your house right now, over your soul right now, of the 12 tribes, listen, and we make progress into the center, you know, weekly.
Yeah.
And what that means is Shabbat is I'm going to take all that I've been doing, you know, in my life, in this blood that he's given me, this red worm blood reality, this Adamic nature that I have down here, and I'm going to go to the center. I'm a sacrifice to God. He led me out of Egypt that I might make sacrifice to Yahweh. Understand that is the purpose for deliverance. That's the purpose for salvation. Salvation is not a bless me club. Salvation is not a club of idolatry. Salvation isn't a place you go for another occupation to become a pastor or a cleric or a priest. It is, he led me out of darkness into the light that I might sacrifice the increase of this light for him and his increase in this dimension. Understand, that's the big picture of why you were created and why you exist. We exist for him, we are created for him, and everything that comes down from him, that trickles down from him, must be sacrificed for him to increase for him. The purpose of completing the mitzvah is to get a better mitzvah. That's what glory to glory actually is.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus is already a perfect friend, and he already owns literally everything in the universe. He owns all the gold and all the gemstones, all the planets, all the solar systems, all the worlds, weeks without end, even Tartarus and the Abyss. He owns all of it. He has the keys to everything. It's all his. So he already has maximum wealth, maximum glory and goodness, and he's the perfect friend. He's the perfect husband. He's the perfect father. He's already perfect, and he already owns everything. So what gift can you give to the man who has everything? He already has everything.
Obedience, a good attitude in your heart. And that's really what we begin to give him, is our souls. He wants our hearts. Rend your hearts and not your garments. Obedience is better than sacrifice. He wants friends that he can speak heart to heart with in transparency. When we're not hiding behind our own idols, making excuses why we're not perfect towards him, but we boldly approach him and allow him to obliterate the separation so that we can have that reconnection, which is two of the 12 tribes. Ephraim and Manasseh, those two flags of Joseph's two sons, are all about reconnecting to the Lord out of the midst of our suffering and chaos. Come on, somebody.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, essentially the latter formation and the circumcision, it's really like sorting out who really wants to be close to him. What's more important, being more like him and obeying him? He said, if you love me, you will obey my commands. And that's Jesus who said that. So when Jesus said, the people who love me, they'll obey, which means what? If you come to the master and creator of the universe with an authentic heart, even though nobody on earth is perfect, you're just being authentic with him. You're being clear heart. You have a clear heart, which means you're okay putting everything on the table. This is me and my intentions. This is what I have. And then all the rest that I don't know in my own heart, I'm just putting it out there. I want to connect with you. You're the creator of the universe. I want to really connect with you in a real way. And I want to know you. What do you require? How can I communicate with you? Receiving communication. That's why the Urim and the Thummim, it was so contended, because that is how you get an actual response from the man who created everything, who has everything. I mean, try to get a hold of celebrity in Beverly Hills. Do you know how hard it is to get a phone number or even to find their, you know, go to their door and knock on the door? You can't go just door-to-door salesman to the celebrities. Did you know Jesus Christ is a celebrity in heaven?
It's true.
I mean, you can't just, you know, a lot of people, he's very humble. He goes to see a lot of people, but a lot of people are very far from his throne in heaven. I mean, he's a celebrity.
Yeah.
And
the angels get nervous when he comes around. Like, this is, oh my, it's the Lord.
You know, the Lord. He's starstruck.
It is sometimes a rare occurrence. Yeah. Heaven is a lot different than people think.
Yeah. I remember one time I was messing up really bad. And I went to heaven, and I was getting my butt handed to me, just pummeled in the heavens, just not understanding, just lack of understanding, because there's nobody out here teaching it. So if I don't receive direct communication, I just go off of my own training and wisdom the best I can. But, you know, we make mistakes, and then we teach you how to do it correctly, so you don't have to mess up as bad as we did on our way up the first time. Yeah, and so that's why there's a lot of grace, people rising. But I just remember being in heaven and going through a replay in the spiritual dimension, showing me what my mistake did to the to a building, a construct in heaven, and how horrible that was. And I was just like, oh my gosh, I can't believe that is terrible. And I know the rabbis, they teach about if you could see like what sin does in the eternal realms, you would be horrified and never ever want to sin. Just like these two stones, like messing up with these two stones, it was horrible. And then I was in a remedial class with John Paul Jackson, yelling at my lowest soul, my nefesh soul, while my higher soul was sitting in a tower dressed in white, just like lovingly watching the whole thing, like, this is nice. Yeah, just give it to her.
Like Sailor Cosmos to Chibi Yusa.
Or Chibi. Yeah, Chibi Yusa needs it too, constantly. You need it.
Sailor Cosmos, mentoring Chibi Ministries.
Well, I guess Chibi is the highest level out of all of the small ones, so it's even backwards. What is it? Like, just the regular earth soul, the Usagi. Like, non-transformed, just a regular person, just tripping over everything, terrible grades.
That's so true. How the nefesh
just constantly
is just
thinking about food.
Yeah.
Food and how she wants to marry her boyfriend. You know, just go hang out with her friends at the cafe. The nefesh life. Our nefesh life needs constant chastisement. So I ended up in a remedial class being yelled at. This was the most loved, by the way, I had felt in my whole life, with John Paul Jackson yelling at me in front of everyone in the room. This was like where the flunk outs go. And I had to go sit in the class. It was to humble me. It was like, oh yeah, here, sit in the remedial class with all the remedial students in heaven. People who are just, they didn't study Torah, they're not good. I'm doing good. Amen. I felt so loved. And when I drew up into like my higher soul's watching, it felt like so much love, and it was just a really precious moment. And I was like, yeah, that's what I need. And
there's correction within light. Light corrects light.
It was great. But I remember then, it was like my Red Rose soul was running around a dungeon having a time of my life just fighting enemies in the ninth week, because there's a lot of enemies in the ninth week that constantly need fighting. That's what the Red Rose soul is for. It's a fighter. Constantly fighting, having a blast, it loves fighting. You should get a ninth week Red Rose soul.
Amen.
It's just a fighter. That's what it's created for.
Each rung is like Gevra.
Yeah. Every rung is Gevra.
It's wild, man. I love it.
Every rung is Gevra. So it's just like, it's really intense energy, but the fighter needs it. Mm. The temper and the discipline, because you get a lot of more power upgrades in the spirit. And so this is about, you know, spiritual battles. The invisible realm is real, if you haven't figured it out by now. We're fighting invisible battles. Everyone fights invisible battles in their whole life. If you haven't figured that out by now, you are way behind from the Great Awakening. Just kind of get with the program. Let's get you caught up to speed. Hey, there's an invisible realm. There's light and there's darkness. Mm. The light is from the creator of the universe, who is actually love, which is YHVH, the angel of Jesus Christ, the real Jesus. And the dark forces are like 200 million fake Jesuses, fake Holy Spirits, demons that counterfeit everything.
Yep.
And they hate you, and they don't want to see you succeed. And those are the things that oppose you. Whenever you start going up in life, mm-hmm. you start doing better, and then something starts attacking you, that's darkness. So you got to have the awakening of realizing the glory of Christ within us. That's the hope that we have.
Haters gonna hate.
Lovers
gonna love.
Oh yeah, but
good eye and evil eye.
Jesus
that's
has a celebrity. So I just got done with my remedial class in heaven and then my ninth week soul and all this fighting battles in the dungeon. And I was like, you know what? I really want to be in the house of God, in the holy places, and not be just like, I don't want to be in detention forever and then having to deal with way more warfare. And so I tried to see, because I get in the back of the limo with my angels, and they're picking me up in the limo in heaven from remedial class. It's just like, it's embarrassing. It's fine. I'm sure you're a much better
I love it.
Believer than I am.
It was a stretch limo.
Yeah, it was. And
pink, probably.
And then the angels are yelling at me, too. And I was like, yeah, I deserve that. But
that's
I wanted
good.
To call. I wanted to see if they could get Jesus on the phone to talk to him about, like, reducing my suffering.
You know, and the red worm really doesn't understand chastisement. Yeah. They often think, the little red worm thinks, well, I'm rejected, I'm hated, I'm despised, I'm just going to go crawl into the dirt again.
Only sons get correction.
No. Only sons get correction. That's how the worm is coming out of the dirt. Now, you have mm-hmm. to, a worm can discern the good eye mm-hmm. or the evil eye. Now, every worm on earth can discern that. And if we can discern that, the Adamic part of us, the nephesh that's in the blood, which is called the little red worm, it can go towards the good eye and begin to blossom. But if it's drawn towards mm-hmm. the evil eye, jealousy, ill will towards others, entitlement, self-absorption, mm-hmm. I deserve everything. Guys, that little red worm mm-hmm. gets augured. And it gets swallowed up by an evil bird, mm-hmm. and next thing you know, you're in the belly of a wicked bird, a foul bird, a fallen angel. And so we really mm-hmm. need to repent, ask Jesus Christ to get us into the good eye. Mm-hmm. And that really is the cave of treasures. Everyone in the whole earth, of all nations, Persians, Babylonians, wherever you come from, can wiggle their little red worm into the cave of treasures through the cross of his blood. Amen. And begin to learn the ladder.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And I want to tell you how much a celebrity Jesus is in heaven. It's just, he's famous. Everyone knows him. It's a privilege to be able to know him. And so I get in the back of this, you know, this stretch limo with the angels. They're, you know, giving me a hard time and all that. Rightfully so. But I wanted to get Jesus on the phone to see if I can lessen my, you know, suffering. I wanted to be in a certain place, you know, like I don't want to make sure, you know, whatever. And the way he answers the phone, and I could see, you know, and how you can, like, see through the phone. He was just, like, having on his sunglasses and, like, all this designer stuff and with his white robe. And he was just talking to me on the phone, like, basically, like, he didn't have to give anybody the time of day. Kind of like, he's really busy, you know, like, he was, I was just like, basically, like, letting me know, like, I don't really have to give you the time of day. Like, he's, like, just letting me see how much of a big shot he is in heaven. And, like, he doesn't really need anybody or anything. Like, he doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. He doesn't need anyone.
It's true.
He's just that hot. You know, he's just that big shot in heaven. Like, he doesn't need anything.
He's the Lord.
And he wanted to let me see that too. He's like, I don't really need anybody.
The Mashiach,
you know,
of Judaism.
Yeah.
If you study Judaism, Mashiach, uh-huh, is the big shot.
Yeah.
Of all Torah scholarship. Like, anytime you come to an important area of Torah, mm-hmm, scholarship, it's always Mashiach, Mashiach, mm-hmm, Mashiach. It's Jesus. He's the big shot, mm-hmm, of everything.
Everything. He doesn't need nobody. Like, he's it. And then, but anyway, so I pleaded my case with him, and he did listen, and then he was like, I'll think about it. I'll let you know by the end of the day. And I was like, okay. How can you believe I was praying that day? Like, till the end of the day. It was like, but it worked out. But he just really wants us to understand the way things actually are. Reality of the situation, he doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. He doesn't need any of this. But why does he do all of this? Why did he do all this? He wants to. He wants to know you. He wants to have a friend. But he wants you to be what? Authentic. He wants you to love him. And by the way, I did get my prayer answered, and it was really good. But I'll never forget that. And you know, he's very gracious. He's extremely wonderful, and he's very kind. So no matter how high you go up the ladder, no matter how big you get in heaven, look, you're never gonna be Jesus. He's everything, and so you can never get so comfortable with Messiah that now you just don't have to be spiritually fit.
There's no angels, yeah, like that.
No, you gotta stay, like, on point.
It's the Lord. Yeah. You know, they tighten up their clothes and be like, you know,
here he comes.
That's how it is.
He's approachable, he's humble, but never forget, he's the King Messiah.
Amen.
He is the King of the Jews. He is the one who created me and you. And but he loves us. He really loves, but he just wants things to be in order in his kingdom, and that's how he wants it. And he should, rightfully so. It's his. I mean, he made it, so he can have it the way he wants. And so let's do that for him. And yeah, it was just a really wonderful experience with Jesus in heaven. And I was all the more glad, you know, just to be like reinstated and put back and everything in order. And it made me realize that it is a privilege and a blessing to be in the house of God. It's not something that you take for granted. At least I can't take it for granted anymore. You know, being a part of his closest friends, and one of his promises to me is to be, you know, very close friend with him for eternity. And so now is actually the time where he's looking for close friends.
Amen.
And here's the wisdom in it. So let's say a rich man shows up who has $1 billion in cash wads hanging out everywhere and all the gold and everything. And he's like, hey, who wants to be my friend? And he rolls up in the Lambo and all that. Everybody is going to say, yep, me, I'm your best friend, right?
It's the Hillsong's,
I'm your best friend.
Pastor.
Everybody. So here's his wisdom. He wants to sort it out, because he wants the authenticity. He wants real friends, not just people who are going to use him for his stuff. Mm. He's already had thousands of years of people using him for his stuff.
Yep.
And honestly, he's not really looking for that at all. So what he does is he'll send some of his closest friends in his place that don't look like much, because we're just worms. And yeah, he sends, like, let me just see how they react to my friends while they're in a certain state.
Let me tell you some Kabbalah. It's the Lord. That's what the the prophets are. They come with instructions down the path of lightning.
He's just gonna sit back and wait.
They always come as little red worms, and people are like,
oh,
manifesting, going nuts. Where's your suit and tie, you know, Elijah?
Why are you wearing sunglasses? What's up with the outfits?
You don't look like a priest, Ezekiel. You know, they got a problem with everything, because they don't like the appearance. You know what that means? They're in total rebellion towards heaven.
Yeah.
Because they're just stuck in the material objects. They're stuck in the elements. They're in hell. Understand that. When you're stuck in materialism, you are literally encased inside the kelapot. And so the prophetic comes. Here comes a little red worm and says, lions roar. It could be some gentle, some water, some air, some fire, the word of God. And it's like it shocks you out of that imprisonment of the kelapot, the red magic spells of the Bilem, and you begin to come into the treasures of God. You begin to listen and learn and understand that God's trying to deliver you from your current situation. And the more you want deliverance, the easier it is. The more you love where you're at, the harder it is. It's impossible for those who love the Kelapot. They have zero chance of even surviving this earth as new earth comes forth from the cave of treasures of our patriarchs. But the ones that are looking for an escape out of the matrix, the ones that are looking for an escape out of the Kelapot, and the evil eye of Samael, and there are millions of those precious souls right now all over the earth ready to be harvested into the cave of treasures of our patriarchs through the cross of Jesus Christ, who forgives them. If they believe in his name, he will wash them in their mind. He will wash them. He will remove the magic spells from their ankles and break off the ball and chain from wherever their feet have gone, wherever their eyes have gone, their heart has gone.
Right.
And he will wash them and move them into a new classroom to learn righteousness.
Amen. Learning righteousness is simply learning how to be a friend of God. It's progressively how to serve him, how to obey him, how to love him. At least minimum bare level is, you know, that Israeli military service. If you can't even be a basic soldier, forget about it. He doesn't want to be friends with somebody like that.
And
I mean, he still likes them.
He loves the grunts. Everyone
so faithful,
that wants
obedient.
To be a five-star general. You can't hang out with you. Your pride, your ego, your self-absorbed.
Five-star general in Satan's
you're
army.
You're a son and daughter of the Bilem.
Yeah.
That entitlement.
He hates that.
But if you're humble and meager, the Gospels say, you know, he's hanging out with the tax collector, the ones that they despise and have the evil eye towards. Jesus came along and said, nope, that's Matthew, writing the Gospel of Matthew, my apostle of the Lamb, Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah, that's so good. Yeah, he... think about... what a friend you may or may not have been to people in your life. Maybe you've been a terrible friend. Maybe you've been a decent friend or a good friend to someone in your life. Think about in your own life. You know, is there an evil eye? When the friends would bring stuff to you, does the evil eye get unleashed? Witchcraft prayers, malintent, the eye of jealousy that brings demonic destruction upon people's hopes and dreams and plans. They come there with their little balloon and you're just waiting there with the needle to pop it. And that's just, you know, the Lord wants people who are going to really be happy for each other. One of the characteristics of the youth army of the future are the ones who can be genuinely happy for each other, no matter how small or big the breakthrough. And I mean genuine, which means there's no evil eye in it. It's only wishing well for everyone, and not just because you know and you think it's the right thing to do. That is the evil eye. When you just think, oh, I shouldn't be jealous, blah, blah, blah. Okay, well, because you're having that spiritual and moral conflict, that means you haven't been set free from the spiritual and moral conflict that talks about in the New Testament writings. So it's got to be true, authentic love formed, which is by default nature never jealous, never envying, never at strife.
No evil eye.
It's not a struggle. The only part that it's a struggle for is the uncircumcised nature. Right? There's only I've seen those memes where they talk about there's only two kinds of people in this world, and there's the two same ladies winning a medal or a trophy. But they're in opposite places. One year, the one lady gets it. And the other one, she's just like, yeah, like clapping for her, genuinely smiling. And then the other time, it's the other lady with the trophy. And she's just like glaring in the picture. They caught it on camera. I was like, oh my goodness.
Yeah.
She was happy for her. She wasn't happy for her. Like, can you rejoice when other people shine? Can you rejoice when somebody else gets blessed? That's how the master of the universe created this universe to work, is that it's going to be as the righteous rise up, it's going to work in favor of those authentic people who can genuinely care for one another, be happy for another. Why? Because you trust that God is fair and he's righteous, that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him, which means by doing the right thing diligently in the holy way, that you trust that God has something good in store for you, and you're content with what he wants to do in your life, which means you're free to be happy for other people and what they're doing. Mm. As long as they're in the holy way with the holy angels, oh yeah, that's God's plan for their life. They're angels. Their angels are friends with my angels. I'm friends with them.
To be an Israelite in ancient times, you had, listen, this is the protocol of Israel. It's written in Torah. You had to be able to rejoice for your fellow Israelite successes. To be an Israelite, you had to have the good eye. The good eye was understood as the Torah, which fulfills the promises of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It's Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob's written under the high priest's breastplate. Well, you know why? The good eye.
Wow.
And so understand, what makes us Christians is that we have a good eye towards others.
Right.
What makes us sons and daughters of that wicked Balaam, the evil eye, which is of all 70 nations, there's jealous haters in all nations, you know how it is out there. And there's wonderful people out there everywhere that actually do rejoice in people's successes and breakthroughs.
Yep.
So it's the separation of the nation's sheep and goats, which isn't your, how people say confession of Jesus and writing out a piece of paper and blah, blah, blah. No, God sees the heart.
Yeah.
So what separates, angel flash right there.
Wow, yeah.
What separates the hearts is the good eye and the evil eye, the sheep and the goat of all nations. The ones with evil eye will be at my left, Jesus Christ, red letters, Gospel of Matthew. They'll be thrown down into the lake of fire with Satan and his angels, because Satan and his angels were their father. But my sheep, which everyone with a good eye, which is goodwill towards others, especially their spouse. Spouse number one, others number two. And that good eye, and your Zadik and your apostles, that's also critically important, because you can't have a good eye and have a bad attitude towards Christian leaders or the true anointed of God, the the judges of the Sephirot and the 24 elders and the Sanhedrin and the Chayot. You have to have a good eye towards those of higher rungs than you. Otherwise, you actually slip off the ones you're on, because you committed murder channeling the Kelopot, and that darkness comes right through your heart, and that's what you're channeling the fallen angels, which is Matthew 5, committing murder in your hearts. So understand, the end times is simply, to my left, the goats with evil eye, Jesus Christ, red letters, to my right, the sheep with the good eye. And we need to produce in our hearts an ever-increasing good eye. Then we'll find the cave of treasures. Real simple. This is very simple stuff. Five-year-olds can understand. You can teach this to toddlers, and they'll understand this. We need to return like little children to enter the kingdom of our Father in heaven right now, because we're so puffed up with knowledge that we've just missed having a good heart, having a good
eye. You can have as much knowledge as possible about mystical things, and you could read everybody's mail. People give, you know, prophetic words, or they
just become scholar demons of Laban.
But then if you're still sipping that haterade, we know what that means. Okay, be happy for each other.
Amen.
Be a blessing and be blessed. When I saw a futuristic vision of the Lord's vision for the new earth, I saw people driving around cars. Everybody was happy. Nobody had that angry rush hour face.
No.
Everybody loved the
honking,
car. They were
honking.
No honking.
It's funny. They honk here 24/7 outside.
This is the worst honking ever.
Oh, my God.
So we need some healing for Miami. Definitely need some healing in this place. Amen. But I saw everyone was just so happy because they knew the car they were driving in was the one the Lord gave them. And there was all kinds of different cars, but they were just so happy, just bliss, just content. And it was like praising God just to drive the car. The honor towards the Lord and the care for others on the road was so intense. They just glory. Just everyone was excited to go where they were going, to go and be a blessing to others.
Amen.
And they were blessed. They were blessed and to be a blessing and to be blessed. And it was bliss.
The cave of treasures in our heart is the new earth.
Yeah.
And it will consume the old earth, which is the good eye consuming the evil eye. And that is what we as sons of God are called to do in this generation. It's that simple.
Mm-hmm. If you're sipping on haterade in this generation, it's because you forgot who the true enemy is. So don't fight each other. It's time to remember who the real enemy is so we can get it together, get up the ladder, find the narrow path, walk in it. Here, this is the way, walk in it. Guaranteed, if God gave you the Holy Spirit, that's the voice that is a small whisper, the voice of one behind you that says, this is the way, walk in it. That means guaranteed, if you have the Holy Spirit, he will tell you where the ladder is and how to walk in it. That's a biblical promise for everyone who receives the Holy Ghost. The only way you cannot find the ladder and not know how to walk in it is if you actively disobey the Holy Spirit to the point you cannot hear him anymore, because he always tells you where the ladder is and how to walk in it.
Amen.
And that's in the Bible. Yep. That's the word of God. So it's time for us to get with it. Be a much better friend to Jesus. If you would like to be a better friend to Jesus today,
yeah,
go ahead and say, put it in the comments. I want to be a better friend to Jesus.
I want to be a better friend of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. That's a good idea, because he's an amazing friend. You're going to learn a lot from him, from his ways.
Next thing you know, we'll be sharing our finger paint.
There you go.
Amen.
Amen.
Your neighbor come around. I have an extra eraser. an extra mechanical pencil. You know, you start to make each other cry by the good eye.
That's right.
That's how we melt the wickedness away. Amen?
Amen. So be restored to at least a kindergarten level of love, caring, and sharing, to where you can even share a pencil or an eraser. And,
Amen.
Yeah.
Love one another as I've loved you. No greater love than this, that we lay down our lives for our friends.
Amen.
And you are my friends if you obey my Torah.
Lay down your evil eye. Put away the evil eye of Sauron.
If you obey my Torah, Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
Throw it in the volcano, Frodo. Throw it away, you know.
The evil eye is going in Mount Doom.
It's going, because then you're going to find you have a friend closer than a brother.
And the orcs just disappear.
They just
which are all the demons.
Yeah.
They get sealed in the abyss for 1,000 years. And the good eye of the cave of Machpelah.
Yeah.
Of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and his sons and daughters inherit the whole earth, and all nations are welcome to the cave of treasures of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob through Jesus Christ, our Messiah.
Amen.
God bless you guys. We'll see you tomorrow. Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed guests and beloved supporters, today I stand before you with a heart filled with gratitude and a vision illuminated by faith. We are gathered here not just as individuals, but as a collective force with a shared purpose, to extend a hand of abundance, to bring forth prosperity, and to manifest the heavenly realities in our world. As we embark on this journey together, I am reminded of the words of Proverbs 3, 9, and 10, which says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine." It is through our acts of honoring and abundance that we have the opportunity to make a tangible difference in the lives of those around us. RLM TV's missions are not confined by geographical boundaries. From the bustling streets of Florida to the sprawling landscapes of America, from the vibrant city of Nairobi, Kenya, to the farthest reaches of the globe, our mission knows no limits. We are driven by a commitment to serve, a commitment rooted in the teachings of Matthew 6:33, where it is proclaimed, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." With your support, we have the power to manifest abundance, to uplift communities, to sow seeds of prosperity that will yield a harvest of blessings for generations to come. Your generosity is not merely a financial transaction. It is an investment in the heavenly realities, an investment in the embetterment of our world. In the book of Malachi 3:10, we are reminded that bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty,
and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be not enough room to store it. Let us therefore open the floodgates of heaven with our giving, with the overflow of our hearts, and with the promise of a more than enough abundance. Today I humbly ask you to join us on this noble journey. Your contributions will enable us to continue this vital work, to reach even further, to serve more, and to manifest the heavenly realities around the world. As you open your hearts and your hands in generosity, may you be blessed abundantly, not just in material wealth, but in the riches of glory, in the joy of giving, and in the knowledge that you have co-created in the building of the kingdom of heaven on earth. As our Jewish sages taught, tithing is the holiness available below. And as our Master Jesus the Christ proclaimed, give and it will be given back to you, good measurements that overflow. Together, let us be the agents of change that our world so desperately needs. Together, let us be the vessels of prosperity that bring forth the heavenly realities. Together, let us make miracles happen. Thank you from the depths of my heart for your unwavering support and your boundless generosity. May the fruitful abundance of heaven overflow in your life. God bless you. Amen. Thank you.